Tonight, some exciting new business ideas from Otago University that promises big things for Dunedin. We visit a school with an unusual open-door policy. And view Dunedin's Rhododendron Dell through the eyes of an overseas expert. Good evening. Dunedin's biggest industry isn't a moneymaker. It's the University of Otago, funded by public money. Well, that's changing. The university's setting out to meet the challenges of underfunding by earning funds for itself. Jim Moore reports the prospects are good for the varsity and exciting for Dunedin.
It's still the nicest campus in the country, despite the state of the leaf in places, and thousands of graduates have fond memories of their time here.
Bright college days, oh carefree days that fly, to thee we sing with our glasses raised on high. Let's drink a toast as each of us recalls ivy-covered professors in ivy-covered halls.
Except there aren't many ivy-covered professors left. The new breed is entrepreneurial, and a glance through the university directory these days reveals many departments that wouldn't have been familiar to students 10 years ago. Unicom is the body set up to encourage research funds into the university to make money and even to attract new industry to Dunedin. The new ventures are marketed under the banner of UniVord, University of Otago Research and Development.
Well, I think the university is aware that the finances that it has are not sufficient, and we do have within the university certain things that we can commercialise, and so a board was set up to look at those commercial opportunities.
A very promising future is forecast for the Energy Management Unit, which is about to become a private company with the university owning a shareholding. This unit, managed by engineer George Riddell, uses computer software to save businesses money on their energy bills. It's reduced energy costs on campus by almost 70% in some areas. UniVord Energy, as the new company will be called, can apply its technology to any building or complex, even private homes. Its future seems bright.
Oh, we actually have clients online now who are probably waiting for us to get on with the job.
More than you expected, this interest that's been shown?
It's very difficult to say, but I guess the economic climate has driven people more towards energy management.
Typically, what sort of savings can you make for firms when they consult you?
Well, based on the savings we've made around campus, we could predict a minimum of about 30%. In a company who initiated our program.
And 30% is, they'd save a lot more than they pay you?
They would have a payback period probably within the first year of operation.
That's fairly impressive.
It's quite good. Accountants seem to like it.
Projected profits for UniVord Energy are $2 million plus in the first 4 years, and the company's confident of exceeding that. University biochemist Dr. Ian Forrester is working in an area that's said to be the growth industry of the future, biotechnology, specifically enzyme technology. Enzyme use is now an indispensable part of our lives, from the hungry enzymes and soap powder to the enzymes used in the manufacture of products like cheese and Pepsi Cola. An enzyme called trypsin is obtained from the pancreases of animals and is used in the treatment of pelts. An ugly-looking pelt like this, when trypsin is let loose on it, ends up looking much more marketable. We import trypsin at great expense, which is silly because the offal that's thrown away at freezing works contains it. Dr. Forrester obtained funding from the meat industry and set about refining the process of trypsin development in his laboratory. Now a plant will be set up here, saving overseas funds and creating jobs. And the story doesn't stop there. Dr. Forrester's investigating other commercial developments of enzymes. For example, trypsin, used for gnawing away at pelts, is worth $100 per kilogram. But used for other purposes, it could fetch $2,000 a kg.
It was the point of the trypsin project, to show we can take one project, take it right through to commercial level, and gain the confidence, yes, we can move on to other projects and start new bio-industries in the south.
You've said that biotechnology has a massive future. When do we have to start moving really quickly on this?
Right now, I'm sorry, Jim, right now we can't delay. The rest of the world is already moving forward at a tremendous rate, Japan, North America and Europe. New Zealand has to move fast. Every day goes by, we're slipping further and further behind. We have the raw materials, we have the people, we have the resources, I think we just have to put them together and just work and concentrate and be positive.
In the chemistry department, Professor Brian Robinson and his assistant Rachel Hannah are working with trees, pink pine trees. They are New Zealand natives and they produce an oil very similar to the whale product ambergris that's used in the perfume industry. Pink pine oil does the same job at no risk to the whales. It's a fixator. It fixes the smell of the perfume so that when you apply it, the odour doesn't fade. The pink pine oil is New Zealand's most valuable export, gram for gram, and just with the enzyme trypsin, people started asking themselves why export the oil when a perfume industry could be set up here. That's just what's happening. A perfume industry based in Dunedin is almost set to go, and the research done in the chemistry labs will mean royalties for the university.
It has the potential of creating the basis for a high-tech industry, and not only for these sorts of materials, but of course once you get the expertise in the environment in the city, then this can lead on to other high-tech products.
The increasing commercial emphasis at the university isn't without its critics. Traditionally, the results of research have been published and available to everyone. Some feel the varsity shouldn't be in the business of servicing private clients, but it appears that's essential if it's to maintain its growth. Also, the varsity's trying to put clauses in its contract so that after a certain time, any research findings are published after the money's come in.
That money, of course, will then go back into the university for things that the university requires. That may be buildings or research or other facilities that we need.
Would it be possible even to set up a sort of science park down here using the resources of the university?
Well, I think we already have one because the university is right in the middle of the city, and in that I think we're very lucky. We're rather different from many of the other universities, but we do have the city industries right up to the edge of our campus. And so whereas other universities have had to go away and set up a science park, we've already got one.
In the absence of new, large manufacturing industries, Dunedin's future prosperity may well lie in the hands or in the brains of university staff. There may be a long way to go before we have our version of a Silicon Valley, but the prospects are definitely encouraging.
We'll keep our fingers crossed, Jim. Now, a look at today's generally mild temperatures. At 3 o'clock, Half Moon Bay was fine with 12 degrees. Invercargill, fine and 12. Gore, clear, 16. Balclutha, windy and 15. Dunedin, partly cloudy and 15. Palmerston, sunny and 20. Oamaru, fine, and the high today of 21. Coorah, fine and 18. Queenstown, cloudy, the low of 11. Wanaka, partly cloudy and 14. Alexandra, partly cloudy, but 17. And Tauranga, 13 degrees. Children are bringing a new twist to tourism in the south, and at a time of growing complaints of overcharging on the tourist trail, their show is absolutely free. Queenstown's Primary School is the first in the country to open its doors to visitors, and as Michael Lynch reports, for many it's the highlight of a New Zealand tour.
It was a privilege. I'm happy I had this special opportunity.
Ordinary tourists, but this isn't a tour the guidebooks list. For years, Queenstown's school's been plagued by visitors, sometimes 100 in a week. Now a teacher's been assigned to show them round and everyone's happier. The children take it in their stride, learn a little more about the world, and the tourists are taking home our textbooks and good impressions.
The children seem to be so eager and they're very advanced, I thought.
Education professionals from overseas are targeting the school for a visit. They're fascinated by our reading recovery programs, by five-year-olds working on computers. The tours have been hard work to organise, but the teachers are basking.
To have a teacher from another land come into your classroom and say, my, how lucky you are and how lucky these children are, make the teachers here feel happier with their lot too.
The main thing that really interested me is your discipline here is so much different than what we have in the United States. If you went into a classroom there, the noise is tremendous. They cannot control them anymore, it seems like. Whether it is our teacher's fault, I don't know. But it's nothing like it used to be at all. Now here, they like that and quiet.
Tourists made the point several times this morning that your children are incredibly well behaved. Why is this?
I hope they struck them on a good day.
Today we've got some visitors from Japan and America. Sometimes we have them from Scott, sometimes we have them from Australia, don't we? Today they've come to listen to our story about the owls.
And another free attraction that's popular with the tourists is the Rhododendron Dell at the Dunedin Gardens. Today it was visited by a man whose travels in search of rhodies have taken him as far as the eastern Himalayas. Tony Schilling is a notable plant collector who's in charge of Wakehurst Place Gardens in England, a branch of the Royal Botanic Gardens Kew. Gaynor Smith joined him at the Dell.
Tony Schilling is an enthusiast about all plants, as befits a man in charge of a British botanic gardens and a former director of the Kathmandu Gardens in Nepal. But today, Dunedin's rhododendrons had most of his attention, with immediate recognition of some old friends.
Oh, yeah, well, it's a lovely garden. I mean, I'm really enjoying myself, and the weather's so beautiful. And this is, rhododendron arboreum, which grows right through the Himalayas from Afghanistan right through into western China. And I've seen lots of these in the Himalayas, and they grow 80 feet high in the best conditions, which is an amazing height for a rhododendron. And this is arboreum, which has a beautiful pink flower in this particular case. Sometimes they're scarlet and sometimes they're white, as you see here. It's all the same species, got a wonderful variation. Even the leaf colour there is, I mean, this one is darker, and this one is silver. It's all the same species, there's great gradation. And so it's really nice to have such a lot of variety in one plant.
Now, you spend a lot of time on plant hunting expeditions. What's the particular thrill in that?
Oh, I think it's the great unknown. You want to know what's over the next ridge, what's around the next corner, maybe something new to science. You know, there are plenty of plants still which haven't come into gardens, especially in some of the great valleys of southwest China and Tibet, where I hope to go next year. But it's the great unknown. It's the big question mark which draws one on.
A brief diversion as he quizzes curator Mick Rees about tree ferns before it's back to the plants that brought him to this country. Invited by the New Zealand Rhododendron Association, speaking to groups in both islands about his expeditions, plant hunting.
Oh yeah, I think it's rather like stamp collecting. You know, it's a living museum at a botanic garden, and we always like to have something unusual, even if it's not as pretty as the other plant. If it's rarer, there's a sort of a, if you like, a sort of gardening snob value to it, and people love to sort of get involved in the detail of plants, as we have just with this one. The variation, the leaf character, some are hardier than others. There's a tremendous interweaving of reason.
Well, so far you haven't had a lot of time to look around, but did you come with any preconceived ideas of rhododendrons underneath?
Well, I'm surprised how much you can grow out of doors unprotected here. I mean, in England, especially in the southeast, we think we've got a fairly mild climate. But some of the things I've seen here this morning, I'm really jealous. Yeah.
Tony Schilling will speak in Dunedin tomorrow night about his recent expedition to a part of China some call the richest source of rhododendrons in the world.
Some fabulous blooms. We'll be back tomorrow night. Good night.